Hello and welcome to Newsfeed, your daily dose of what people are talking about online, from news stories to what's trending. Competition is fine, cheating is not. Well, the words of Elon Musk as his lawyers at Twitter threatened to sue Meta following the launch of Threads. The app stole the spotlight from the Blue Bird when it launched on Wednesday and upset Twitter owner Elon Musk, so much so that he may be preparing to take his cage fight with Mark Zuckerberg to the courtroom. Musk's lawyers say Meta has created a copycat app and used Twitter's former engineers to build it. Away from the legal battle, the app's thread count continues to stitch at an impressive rate. Threads quickly needled itself to the top of the App Store and has already surpassed 50 million users. Like all those new signups, my team and I also took Threads for a spin. Here's Sare with her first impressions.
It's a big day for social media. Meta has launched its self-described sanely run Twitter alternative earlier than expected. Meta has been looking for an opportunity to release a competitor to the platform for a while now, and looks like what's happening over at Twitter lately might have given them the perfect window. In just 7 hours after they opened the gates, 10 million users have signed up to the platform, in line with Meta's expectations of having tens of millions trying Threads in the first few days. You create a Threads account using Instagram, and mainly because of that, the environment there feels a lot more lighthearted than Twitter. While it's still early days and the platform will adjust according to its community, it currently feels a lot like the early days of Facebook. Posting feels like writing on someone's wall. In the future, it may turn into a platform similar to Tumblr, for fun, friends, fandoms, and trash posting. And if you were looking for a more serious, debate-focused alternative, Mastodon might be a better pick for you. But worry not, since the goal for Threads is to be decentralized, meaning it can connect to Mastodon and be a part of that ecosystem. So you won't even need a Mastodon account to join the discussions over there. Trying to come up with thread puns might be a fun time on the app, but the platform is far from perfect. Crucial features like private messages, editing and drafting posts, and a chronological feed for those you follow is still missing. Threads currently runs according to Instagram's rules, but as Meta moves more towards a decentralized system, you will be able to shape your part of the platform to your liking. You can join Threads simply by connecting your Instagram. But if you're in the EU, you will have to wait for Meta to comply with the bloc's data regulations before getting on the app. While it's early to call whether this will be a Twitter killer or not, still, Threads made it to my phone's homepage faster than many other apps.
From the newest kid in the social media space to curbs on U.S. government officials restricting content on online platforms, a Trump-appointed federal judge barred some members of the Biden administration from speaking to social media firms about removing content. This related to the COVID-19 pandemic and misinformation about U.S. elections. The lawsuit was filed by the attorney generals in Louisiana and Missouri.
Judge Terry Doty calling the Biden administration's efforts a massive attack against free speech and targeted suppression of conservative ideas, adding in part, quote, American citizens have the right to engage in free debate about the significant issues affecting the country. The decision means top White House officials and several federal agencies, including the FBI and the Department of Justice, cannot communicate with social media companies for the purpose of urging, encouraging, pressuring, or inducing in any manner the removal, deletion, suppression, or reduction of content containing protected free speech. They can, however, contact them regarding any potential illegal activity and national security threats.
The U.S. Department of Justice and the White House are reviewing their options. The preliminary injunction will stand until the matter is appealed. Free speech is a hot topic in America. There's those who want to protect the public from speech that would harm them or suppress democracy. Others who are fighting for their First Amendment rights to say what they want, even if it's not true. And with tech giants trimming trust and safety teams, one has to wonder how misinformation can be controlled online, especially if government experts can't weigh in to prevent crises and health emergencies.
Say this case was one of the greatest threats to public health had ever made its way into the courts. That is very important for government scientists who spend their life trying to protect the public to be able to speak out and try to protect the public.
In today's tech-driven world, where algorithms and automation reign supreme, some executives are breaking free from their offices and getting their hands dirty. Leading the way is Andy Fang, Chief Technology Officer and co-founder of U.S. food delivery service DoorDash. Lara takes us along for this ride.
I think the directions of the app are actually slightly off.
Stepping into the front line, Andy Fang is part of a growing movement among executives who are putting on the uniforms of their employees to truly understand their jobs. Today, he's out delivering a package. But there is an unexpected challenge waiting for him.
There is a mistake in the restaurant address, so we had to kind of walk a block and a half to get to the actual restaurant. And then, I think figuring out how to just get to the customer.
It's errors like these that Fang wants to know about so he can find solutions.
It happens with one restaurant. It might actually be happening, with a lot of other restaurants as well. So I think if we can see why that happened, maybe we can fix other issues too.
Fang is not the only one in his company to get hands-on experience. DoorDash has introduced a program called WeDash, requiring all employees to complete a minimum of 4 deliveries per year.
The delivery company just reinstated their WeDash policy. With this in place, all employees up to the CEO must complete 1 DoorDash delivery a month. The program just started up again this month, and there's already been a lot of pushback. It seems the higher level employees are the most upset about the policy.
A DoorDash employee making $400K a year complained about a company-wide initiative requiring that he personally make 1 delivery a month.
What the actual I didn't sign up for this. There was nothing in the offer letter / job description about this.
Despite some complaints, Fang firmly supports the program.
Really it's just an opportunity for me to get to know the product. What we quickly found out was that by doing these deliveries ourselves, we learned a ton of insights into what it took to actually get these deliveries fulfilled as a Dasher.
DoorDash isn't the only company embracing this approach. CEOs across various industries are rolling up their sleeves and immersing themselves in the day-to-day operations. This hands-on involvement provides them invaluable knowledge and nurtures empathy, ultimately driving positive change within their organizations.
Few television shows, including this one, have attracted reviews quite like this.
One of the worst programs ever made.
An atonal pileup of hazy character motives, narrative dead ends, and remarkably unsexy sex scenes.
The show is dogged by a thin plot and an incoherent narrative.
All right, music. Having created a positive buzz at its premiere in Cannes, creators Sam Levinson and Abel the Weekend Tesfaye predicted they had the show of the summer. Starring Lily Rose Depp, yep, Johnny Depp's daughter, The Weeknd himself, and K-pop star Jennie from Blackpink, big spenders HBO thought they had a hit on their hands. But the idol was panned by the press, and the public's reaction to it was a measly 9% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Trust me. So I just finished the last episode of The Idol, episode 5. And I've got to say, that was what I had in my head, like as far as like the worst possible scenario, this was actually worse than anything I could have ever envisioned, and wow.
But has the idol fallen into the it's so bad, it's good category? Well, somehow it's eclipsed HBO's acclaimed The Last of Us and Netflix Wednesday in online engagement. And in a bizarre twist, this song has become a smash hit. I'm just a freak, yeah. You know I want it bad. In the plot, this song, world-class singer I'm a Freak, shows a washed-up and bored Jocelyn Even her team think it's terrible, and her career has hit rock bottom. But in the real world, people have been raving about this song. Once it dropped on Spotify back in June, it has been streamed over nearly 14 million times. So the idol has a hit on its hands after all. All right, on to what's trending. Well, unless you've been living under a rock this past month, you've probably heard the viral song Makeba while scrolling through Instagram or TikTok online. But what's the backstory behind the catchy tune that's catapulted into the public's consciousness? Well, Nick brings us some answers for that.
It's the ultimate sleeper hit. Jane's song Makeba is topping charts again, 8 years after its release and Grammy nomination for this artsy music video. Track's comeback is thanks to TikToks and Instagram reels like this. It all started on June the 1st when this TikToker combined the earworm with a Saturday Night Live sketch of actor Bill Hader. This was the meme that launched 1,000 memes. Even celebrity chef Gordon Ramsay got in on the fun.
Nobody can beat the Mama Africa. You follow the beat that she's gonna give ya.
But the French artist's track is more than just a lively number. The 2015 song pays homage to legendary South African singer Miriam Makeba. The prominent anti-apartheid activist was affectionately known as Mama Africa.
Miriam Makeba was born in Johannesburg. She was the first of the great singers from her country to bring South African music to the world.
She was exiled from South Africa for 3 decades and never shied away from advocating for equality.
The conqueror writes history. They came, they conquered, and they wrote. Now you don't expect people who came to invade us to write the truth about us.
Makeba passed away in 2008, but today her music and powerful message live on.
I wanna see you sing, I wanna see you fight, 'cause you are the real beauty of human rights.
And that's our show. Find us on YouTube and do subscribe to our channel. See you soon.